southern Denmark, and it's on towards UAV Tonto flight, which will be an interesting thing to understand what's going on. Many of you will be sitting with potential applications that will utilize have other applications, please come forward and talk to me after the session. The drone platform we are using, we basically needed a drone platform that we could access directly into the inner core of the firmware of the flight controller. And we chose the AutoQuad. This is a standard small drone on about a kilo. The interesting part is the flight controller is open sourced, and it scales up to very big drones, and the smallest drones we have are about 35-40 grams. So it's easy to develop on the small drones and move on to the bigger ones. What we have done with the drone is we have refurbished the firmware. We have added potential input for position information beyond what is already on there. Like any other flight controller, there is an onboard standard GPS system that works very well, but we are adding the ability to switch between that and an external input, which we pass in by a canvas on the flight controller. In order to add some hand information on the drone, we just put a Raspberry Pi on it. This is just for the sake of the experiment. And it has a kind of adapter connector so that we connect to the drone that way. And then we take a Trimble RTK-GPS. It's a very small OEM module that we looked into and found out it was a nice thing to work with. It was still too heavy, so we refactored the external interface to get it down to 183 grams. That is for a complete RTK-GPS with antenna, with GSM antenna and the cables needed. I haven't seen that before. And we can get further below because there is a new module which will make it easier for us. The problem here, if it's a problem with 183 grams, is that we have an entire GSM with a cell phone running system. And we don't need that. We can simply put the correct information through the normal telemetry to the problem. So we can probably get down to, I would say, a little more than 100 grams when we finish with the project. And it gives us the accuracy. Right now, we haven't had a chance to evaluate the accuracy in air using ground truth reference data. Obviously, if you have an application which you normally trust it, this is not necessarily the case when you put it onto the drone, because one of the biggest risks is actually to have what's called multi-path signals, where the signals from the satellites hit the ground first and then get reflected up to the drone. We don't see that in ground-based robotics in this culture. But when you have a drone, say 50 meters above ground, the distance becomes significant and you start having problems. We have a way of testing that, we haven't got it. The experiment, we looked into the digital innovation model as presented by Morten Larsen. Because basically, if you want to do stitching of photos using the IMU and the GPS, if you can move on to RTK-GPS, the calculation becomes much more efficient, and that means you need to have less computer power on the drone itself than you can do online. So, in order to make it easy for the calculation, you want to have a fixed elevation above the terrain. And looking into the same digital elevation model, we created a small tool that can generate the route planning and then extrapolating the height above terrain from this database. And that seems to work very well. We are not yet at a stage where we induce intermediate points if it's a very curved terrain, but that's just a matter of programming. We have all systems in place for that. And we created this small test flight. And to be honest, we haven't been flying it that many times, only a few times. And the results I'm going to present here is from the flight that created the worst results, just for itself. We will continue this work after the summer holiday. The results here show that on errors we can keep horizontal a distance of 45 centimeters. We do have a maximum at 1.35 meters, and that is too much for us. We're going to dispense or spread beneficial above the Christmas trees. It doesn't work if they are 1.35 meters away because the beneficial will hit the ground and they are capable of climbing back onto the tree. So we need to get within this half a meter and we will do that. On the vertical, it's actually easier for the drone because it comes as a bit of a surprise to us. But we haven't looked very much into that yet. If you look at where the inaccuracies are, is actually when it's in route on the long stretches. So it means that the velocity of the drone has something to say. We've set 5 meters per second, and we probably won't go below that because we also need to get some endurance on the drone so we can actually cover the field in the lifetime of the battery. And we do have a number of other places where we can look into the accuracy. The potential error source that we have identified beyond the velocity is that this drone that we're using, one of the reasons for using it is that, in contrast to most of the drones that is out there, it actually uses not a kinematic but a dynamical adaptive controller. It means that it's much more able to fly in windy weather and next to a, let's say that we want to navigate very close to a wall where it could be a row of trees, then it's much more efficient, it's much more easy to navigate, both autonomous and when you do it as a pilot. The problem is we haven't had the time yet to tell that we add extra weight to the drone. So right now the controller is actually fighting our extra added weight in different places of the drone. That's an easy one to solve, we just haven't had the time yet. The GPS is currently updating at 5 Hz, and it can actually do 20 Hz. At 5 Hz, it means we get only one update per meter. And obviously that's a very poor sensor to navigate by. The reason we haven't moved up yet, because it's just a matter of configuration, is that we have this firmware in the flight controller. And the problem, in contrast to the many autonomous robots we were building for business agriculture, is that when you hit the stop button, the drone falls. And we have already lost some amount of landing gears and propellers in this experiment. So the idea of adding extra input to a software system is something you only do when you do rigorous testing, that you do not create buffer overflows or some problems with the processor capacity and so on. So it will take a few months for us to actually go through the process of making so big differences to the firmware. The location of the GNSS antenna, you can see that the black thing next to the center, the thick black one. The reason for that is ideally it will have to be put on the center of the drone, but when you do experimenting with new systems, you want to be able to switch back to the standard. So we typically have a switch on the transmitter, so we can launch the drone using the standard GPS, and then we flip the switch and we switch over to the RTK GPS. Obviously, the two antennas cannot sit in the same position. We don't know yet how much it means, but it does mean something. And then the accuracy with inside this flight controller, there is a standard Kalman filter that makes the position estimation based on all the sensors it has. And right now we are telling the Kalman filter that the accuracy of this RTK GPS is about half a meter. The reason we are doing that is when we flip the switch between a standard GPS and a GPS that's that accurate, then you may have a few meters in between the positions. And if you tell the filter that it's within the centimeter, the drone starts to jump in the air. We've seen that it was one of the landing gears. So we are not really there yet, but we will be in a few months. And based on that, I'm pretty sure that we will make the threshold of 0.5 meters in accuracy. So the conclusion is that we have all the system in place. We definitely need to do more testing. We need more applications. We need to evolve on our route plan using the elevation model. And we also need to do testing if it actually works to the accuracy with the elevation model that we expect. We need to look into other. GPS types, more expensive and more low cost. And one thing I've got to say is very interesting. We haven't seen a single problem during our tests with the RTK GPS. Not a single fallout from what's called fixed RTK. So actually switching from single frequency to dual frequency makes a huge difference. All the experiments we've done with single frequency GPS receivers have periodic fallouts. Meaning basically that you cannot use it in environments where you really need the accuracy, or if you have the applications where you are surveying, then you basically need to stop the drone and wait until you reacquire this system. With this system, we haven't seen it yet. It may come, but it's certainly to come. So the work ahead, I was talking a bit about that before. We're going to move on to this bigger drone. We just got it. This one is capable of actually carrying these beneficials that we are working with. Same flight control, so it should be fairly easy. One very interesting thing that we're looking into is we just got a new collaboration working with light of view systems. We're going to mount a laser vision on the drone and then using a serving with a toaster station to track the drone. Because this way we can actually get some ground truth reference on where the drone is. And obviously we'll also investigate, can we use the toaster station to serve the toaster station for navigating the drone as well. There are some challenges, but if we can, then we can create millimeter precision accuracy estimation on a drone inside GPS denied areas. And that is very interesting. That could be inside forests, it could be in orchards with very heavy leaf covers and so on. So that's certainly going to be interesting as well. Finally, if you have applications where this might make sense, please talk to me. I will be very interested in hearing.